Thinking of using Mixpanel, but not sure if it's worth it? In this video, I'm sharing my honest experience after using Mixpanel for the past 30 days and on and off for the past 10 years. From the pros and cons to the features I loved, the things that I think Mixpanel doesn't do that well, and how it all comes together if you're thinking about a tool to analyze your product, your marketing, or just your data in general. Stick around and see my final score for Mixpanel in 2025. Let's jump right in. Let's start with the interface. After all, you're here to build reports. So this is the classic report in Mixpanel called Insights, and building them is honestly great, right? We can take any event we have here. Right away, within a few seconds, we get the data. We can break this down by all kinds of properties, right? Assuming we have passed them into Mixpanel. I'll talk about that in a second. Lots of different chart types, lots of different breakdowns by day. You can compare against other periods. And generally speaking, it's a very great interface. Now, if you look at funnels, for example, and we were, for example, going to take, let's say, a video. We're going to watch a video, and then we're going to purchase a video. A simple two-step funnel. And we go into funnel steps here. We get it. We're kind of breaking it down by category, but we can actually just see the entire funnel overall. Easy peasy. Interface, fantastic. And I love some of the details. So it's very easy to get started. And there's lots of different things that you can build into it. You can have custom colors in the charts. If we go back to Insights, actually, down here, there's a couple custom things that Mixpanel has added. For example, you know, this attributed by is this custom way to do attribution, a last touch, a first touch. There's all the kind of functions you might expect, the sum, the min, the average, different ways of combining events. So overall, the interface to me is a 10 out of 10. It's just a great way to interact with data. These are the basic reports. Now, what about dashboards? Let's look at that next. Dashboards in Mixpanel are called boards. They cannot afford the four letters of the word. So boards are very good as well. So here is a sample board from a sample data set here in Mixpanel. What I like about this is you have flexibility in the date range up here, of course. You have the ability to add charts and to add text. Text in particular is very helpful because you can add context to all the charts that you have. Every chart has different ways of showing it. So you can actually change the chart type here, you know, from a bar or to a line or to something else, depending on what kind of chart you add. And of course, you build your reports and then you add them to a dashboard. So you can still actually dive deeper into any report by just clicking into it, which is also great. Some people really just want to work with the data on their own, add their own filters, and this kind of allows for both. So you get the overview and it gives people the ability to dive deeper into them. Some of the charts here you can see, let me see a couple of things here I also want to show. We have TV mode if you have TVs in your office. We also have subscriptions, and this simply means that you can take any board, for example, the one we just saw before, and we can send it by email or Slack on some kind of frequency. So again, very handy as a way just to circulate the data. On the dashboards, I would give it a 9 out of 10. It can do almost everything. I think there are some limits around chart types, which is just limited in Mixpanel itself compared to something like a Tableau or Looker Data Studio, but very solid dashboard functionality as well. The next question is, how hard is it to get data into Mixpanel? Let's look at that next. For this, we start with the SDKs. So down here, we have the JavaScript SDK. This is, of course, perhaps the most common way to get data into Mixpanel if you're tracking custom events. I'll note here that as January 2025, they're also about to add auto capture, which can be very helpful if you've seen tools like Heap. Nonetheless, we have lots of different SDKs down here. JavaScript, React Native, Android, iOS, all the standard ones are here. There's backend ones. There's, an API endpoint you can use, which means you can do anything. So there's very good SDKs. I also like to look at the documentation itself to see how well structured it is. And if we're honest, the Mixpanel documentation is very solid. You can see there's lots of information here, code samples. There's different details about that may come up depending on what data you're tracking. There's use cases like, you know, if you want to bring historical data in and so on. So this to me is fantastic documentation. It clearly has been built over many years. And it's just a great way to interact with the SDKs. No issues there. We also have, in the same place, integrations. So if you have other tools in your stack, let's say like an AppsFlyer for mobile attribution, Braze for email communication, or something else, you're likely to find it here. Generally, again, data into Mixpanel is not going to be an issue. Some things might require a little bit more work. You know, we have some, for example, ad platforms like AdSpan here. Mixpanel provides some instructions, which requires Google Cloud to get it done. It's not complex. It's possible to get it here. So from a data in perspective, I just think it's a really great tool as well. Again, you're unlikely to run into issues trying to get data into Mixpanel. And overall, I will also rate the SDKs and the data in functionality a 10 out of 10. What about if you want to get data out? Let's look at that next. So when it comes to data out, we're going to look at integrations. So we're going to go up here to the top right, integrations, and we're going to load a few things here. So data warehouses are all here, the standard, BigQuery, Snowflake, Redshift, no issues there. It does require an add-on on the pricing page, which we're going to look at the very last section, but they're all here and they all work as expected. Now for other tools, there's about 60 potential tools right now as of time of recording this video. You're going to see pretty standard things here. Here's Braze, MailChimp will be down here, Facebook Ads, I think Google Ads is down here. Generally good tools. I would actually say this is the weaker part of Mixpanel. You can see that all of this data is actually exported in cohorts. There's really two ways you can take data out of tools like Mixpanel. You can take cohorts, which means you're taking a list of users. Let's say you have a cohort of the new users over the last 30 days. Mixpanel can export that list, let's say 1,000 users, to a bunch of tools, and then you can send them messages. This is handy, but the second way you can get data out of these tools is exporting the actual raw data, that is the events and the event properties and the user properties. So you're not just exporting the list of users with their emails, which is typically what this is. You're also going to export the user profile properties that you have attached in Mixpanel. That kind of makes your Mixpanel data much more portable. You can take it to different tools and use it in different ways. So the integrations typically do not do this out of hand. You of course have APIs, you can write your own integrations, you can go find some external tool that can do it. That, of course, is always a possibility, but just out of the box, I would say the data out functionality in Mixpanel is not as strong, and I would rate it a 6 out of 10. Next, it's 2025. How well has Mixpanel adopted a lot of the AI developments that we have seen all over the industry? First, Mixpanel has something they call Mixpanel Spark. It's kind of their integration with ChatGPT. There's a documentation on it if you want to see it. It's a bit weird to find, in my opinion. You actually have to go into a new board. And then once you're in that new board screen, which is here, you get some options. You can take templates that Mixpanel has built around common things you might see. Those are very handy, actually. Or you can add existing reports, or you can launch Spark right here. So again, it's a little hidden in the menus. When you launch this, it kind of gives you natural question language. So you can kind of write something here based on the data you have, and it will build something for you. I played around a little bit with this, and other tools have something similar. I just don't think it's very good. It's honestly creates very basic things that might just take less time than it would take you to actually just write the question. So I would say this is not a good adoption yet compared to what some other tools have done. In terms of the machine learning, of course, Mixpanel has had some machine learning reports for a few years now. Some of the more common ones are something like Signal, where it tries to help you find correlations between your data and certain conversions. So for example, a long time ago, Facebook made something famous because they realized that if users added 7 friends in 10 days, they were more likely to be retained. So Signal and a few other reports have been built around this. I would say the Mixpanel has a few of these reports, maybe between 2 or 3. Some are available at the middle growth plan, and some are just enterprise level plans. But again, I wouldn't say they're also as strong as what other tools have. Amplitude, for example, may have double the amount of machine learning power reports, and they're actually LLM AI is actually pretty good as well. So on the AI development and machine learning, I would rate it 2 out of 10. I only mention this because I actually think the LLM stuff like the ChatGPT can be a really powerful way to interact with data, and I really wish Mixpanel would do more around that. But so far, not so good in 2025. Of course, our final section, how much will Mixpanel cost you? Let's look at that. Now, Mixpanel has a free plan with 1 million events at the time it is recording. 1 million events is not bad as a starter point. They charge per event instead of monthly track users like other tools do. Generally speaking, charging by events tends to be better for B2C apps, not so much for B2B. I do find that it's a little easier to optimize what events you send versus what parts of your product you don't track if you're trying to limit your monthly track users. Now, the same 1 million events, they will cost you $168 per month. And there's about a 30% discount if you actually get the annual amount. That discount will probably range between 20 and 30%. And then it kind of scales from there. The scalability is nice because that means you can, as your usage grows, you can kind of grow slowly with Mixpanel on the pricing plan. Some of the tools tend to jump you from a free plan into right away like a 20K a year plan. And then you kind of go up from there on the custom sales process. So I do find the ability to go up to at least the 20 million events before you talk to a sales rep can be a nice addition, and you can sort of control it and decrease it as you see fit. There's two add-ons you can add right now. Data pipelines, which is just scan the data out to Redshift and Snowflake and BigQuery. This, to me, is actually quite handy because you can do a lot of custom calculations in a data warehouse. So I would consider this almost essential to keep your data portable. And then group analytics, which is more relevant if you're B2B and you're trying to tie users to a group like a company. So you may have a client company and then multiple employees in that company who have individual users. So generally, pricing is what I would consider more startup friendly. There are startup discounts if you qualify, so you can check those out. A couple of things on the free plan. You know, I work with this free plan for many months. Some of the major limitations is really around how many reports you can save. I believe it's 5 per user. This means that you can build a lot of reports, but you can't save them, so they're kind of disposable in a way. And honestly, if you're kind of getting started with Mixpanel, I would at least take the growth plan and maybe optimize your event count if you're concerned about pricing, and because at least you're going to get a bunch of other things like cohorts, exports, and a bunch of other stuff that can be quite handy. So how does Mixpanel stack overall? If we add all the score, we get a score of 44 out of 60, or 73%. You might have your own criteria, of course. The criteria I use is really a tool that has a great interface. A great way to show and report data. It's really the bread and butter of Mixpanel. It's relatively easy to get data in. You have lots of options from the SDKs to different tools. It is much weaker to get data out, so you want to keep that in mind. The AI adoption has not been very good, in my opinion, despite this now being a few years of it. I wish Mixpanel would do more around that. And I will consider the pricing pretty standard. You know, tools either charged by event or by monthly track users. Mixpanel has chosen the former. And I find the scalability of pricing to be quite nice. So you can kind of play around with Mixpanel before you really commit to a long-term sales deal. That's all I have for today. I hope you enjoyed this short review of Mixpanel. My name is Ruben Garter. I am an expert in MarTech. There's a few links in the description. If you're looking to sign up with Mixpanel, of course, there is a link. It is an affiliate link. So if you want to support the channel, you can use that link. There's also links if you want help implementing Mixpanel on a consultant basis. You can check that out. I work with a handful of companies every year. And finally, if you're looking for your next video to watch, you should check out this Mixpanel tutorial I recorded a few months ago. It is much longer. I believe it's about 60 minutes in length, and it covers everything from start to finish, what it takes to really implement Mixpanel, the track and plan, how to work with SDKs, how to make decisions between client and backend data, and a bunch of other things. So the video will appear right here, and I highly recommend you check it out if you want to see a little bit more in depth what it takes to really get Mixpanel to a point where you can do a lot of the cool things that you saw in this video. Until next time, we'll talk soon.